This is episode 103 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For June 2019, we're discussing At the Water's Edge by Sara Gruen. Hi, so I'm Millenia in Vietnam.
And I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club. And today we are discussing our group's 223rd Cove pick, At the Water's Edge by Sara Gruen. And it was chosen by Cove member Cheryl in Arizona. So we are beginning our discussion with the rest of the group online today. And what did you think?
Well, the story and how they tied things together, because at the very beginning, when they had this the really tragic thing about the I don't know how you pronounce Marie, you know, her husband, she got the notice that her husband had been killed in the war, because mm-hmm. during World War II.
Right.
So her husband died, her baby died, she lost her baby early on. And so she was so despondent that she just went to the water's edge and drowned herself. She just couldn't deal with it. So I thought, well, how is this going to be part of the story? But the author, little by little, wove that early episode into the story. So, eventually you go, aha, this is why they had this, how this all worked.
How it tied in.
Then the other thing that was interesting to me earlier in the book is they had the verse about the crows, about the one crow for this and two and so forth. Mm-hmm. And I read, and I can't remember the title, I'm sorry, too many books, but I remember they had that same thing about crows in another book I read recently. Mm-hmm. So crows sort of always seem to foretell bad stuff, tragedy.
Right.
And everything, and they even call a group of crows a murder of crows, so
mm-hmm.
they look kind of, dark and ominous.
Right.
So I was thought it was interesting how she used this same thing, but apparently she used it, since this book is a little bit older, she used it before this more recent book that I read, so I thought it was interesting. But both of these things take place in, both things I believe took place in England, so I think it's more of an English common verse.
Well, this book was in Scotland, right?
I mean, Scotland, pardon me.
Yeah,
Scotland, the UK, I'm sorry. Scotland, it was a lock. That's right. Pardon me, I got confused here. But anyway, but this thing about the crows must be sort of a UK type of verse that learned early on.
Well, for me, I just think this author's writing style just isn't for me, because I had the same experience when we read Water for Elephants, which I think was also a Cove pick back in the day. The writing is kind of dull and just unengaging to me, so it doesn't hold my interest. But as I was saying to you before, I loved the movie that was based on her book. So I think the story's good. She just doesn't tell it in a very engaging way for me. Not my cup of tea. In this one, specifically, At the Water's Edge, in the beginning, Maddie and Ellis and Hank, I thought they were so boring. It was like they're just partying it up, and then Ellis's father disinherits him or whatever, so they get in their head they're gonna go find the Loch Ness Monster to try to make him happy, because his father had tried to find it years before and it didn't work out, or he had staged pictures, or I don't remember. So Ellis decides he's gonna, they need to go over there in wartime, which was ridiculous, and try to find this Loch Ness Monster. I was just like, really? And then as they're on the boat, it was just boring. It's like champagne problems. Like, who cares about these people? I didn't.
I think they were supposed to reflect these people that were, rich and bored and really didn't have to work for a living, because Ellis, he didn't have a job. He just, had this money, this allowance.
Yeah. And so his father cuts him off, and then he's like, what's he going to do with it? He's got a wife to support.
Right. So, but Hank has money regardless. So he figures his old buddy Hank will take care of him.
But wasn't he in love with Hank? I picked that up, that I think...
She didn't ever come around and say it, but yeah, that the three of them had been friends,
mm-hmm.
and, they really, like she said, she found out later she was like part of a coin toss, you know. Mm-hmm. Either Hank or Ellis were going to marry them because that would hide their relationship, because for sure back in, you know, those days it was really scandalous and frowned upon.
Taboo, yeah.
So that this would, like, you know, make it look all fine and dandy that they were, you know, just a threesome and everything. So, and, you know, but she probably, I guess, when she looked back, she realized something was off, you know, even before this horrible revelation. Mm-hmm. That he just didn't seem like he was very amorous and, you know, wasn't what a real husband should be.
Right, because he was gay.
Right.
That's
right.
What so I thought.
That's what I thought, too. You know, they don't come right out and say it, but little by little, that's what you realize, that that's what has to be. And then, you know, Hank has this girlfriend, Violet, but he's put her on hold for so long. Mm-hmm. And, you know, keeps thinking, well, he'll marry her and that'll look good, and then they could be, you know, two couples and everything will be hunky-dory. But you find out that it's really, she's what they call a beard.
Right.
She's there to make sure that nobody gets wind of what things are really going on.
Exactly. Because
that even though she didn't want to go anyway, here they just go off and leave her, mm-hmm. you know, a couple of times. You yep. know, once over there in Scotland, and it's like they don't give any thought to her, and when she fusses, and they're going, well, you know, they were pretty awful. I mean, Maddie was sort of a dupe in this thing,
yeah.
And Ellis and Hank were just out to have fun, and try to get this notoriety or mm-hmm. from the scandal before, but they were trying to make a name for themselves, you know, if they could actually find the real monster and take a picture of it. And it would, like you said, it would get Ellis back in his daddy's good graces, mm-hmm. that accomplished something that his dad wasn't able to. But like I said, like they say later in the book, they were the ones that were really the monsters.
Right. I think there was a lot of, as you mentioned about the crows, symbolism
right.
in this story.
At the end, you don't know. Do you think, did the monster really show up? Did the, you know, monster save Maddie from being killed?
Right.
Just flip back. But then the film was lost. You know, it was lost because Ellis didn't want this film to show that he tried to murder his, or he was murdering his wife, trying to drown her. Mm-hmm. So you never know, was she really saved by that or not? Because she sort of had these premonitions about things sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, and she wasn't sure, but she thought that one time she saw Mary, you know, there, and then she'd seen the other, I forget how you pronounce it, but the other thing that the people at the inn said, oh no, something horrible is going to happen, and it did.
Right.
Anna's brother was killed, you know, during the battle. Mm-hmm. So Maddie had these visions, and you have to tend to think, well, was it just a coincidence, or did she really have some sort of innate ability to connect with things?
Right. And then she ended up with Angus.
Right. So, I mean, at least it had a happy ending, even through all this other terrible stuff. And one of the things that stuck with me the most, like you said, the thing about the boat in general was sort of boring, but then that one ship was torpedoed and they took on survivors, and Maggie saw these horribly burned men. I just thought, ugh.
I know.
That was just something I thought, you know, that kind of stuck in my brain, that for her to think, you know, she saw these horrors of the war. She'd been so far removed from it, being back in the United States, than to see up close and personal what was really going on. It was a different sort of horror and experience where she could see what the war really was. Of course, then when they were there at the inn, then they had to deal with the everyday life there with the blackout curtains and then the bomb shelter.
Yeah.
You know, this went off. I liked that it didn't all come at once, but little by little she realized who Angus really was. That, you know, because at first she thought the A stood for another person. Mm-hmm. And then she found out he was the one that, you know, he hadn't really died. He had lived and he'd had to deal with all this grief of losing his wife and his child. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it took him a long time to get better and get back home. So,
yeah.
But the people at the inn, at first they were kind of cold, but I think little by little they learned that you know, these other guys were awful, but she was really a good person, a kind person.
Yeah, but I think that I got the impression that the only reason they were allowed to stay was because Angus liked Maddie from the start.
Yeah, he felt this, you know, kinship to her of some sort. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if it hadn't been for her, they would have been kicked
out. Yeah.
They were just, you know, they were treating these people like dirt, because even if they were truly servants or whatever like that, you just don't treat people like that.
Exactly.
You know?
But, you know, they were bougie people, rich.
Right, but, you know, even then, not all rich people have to be that, you know, mean and ugly to people.
Right,
but that's
right.
How they,
of
they
course
seen,
not, yeah.
Well, they had seen, you know, especially Ellis, he had seen how his father was, because his father wasn't exactly warm and fuzzy either.
Right.
And then I thought it was sort of sad that when Maddie got so scared about what was going on, she, you know, was writing her father to come rescue her, but he was saying, no, can't do that. You got to take care of it yourself. Mm-hmm. So in a way, it seemed kind of heartless, but at the same time, of course, there wouldn't have been the rest of the book if he'd done
He kind of forced her to become who she became, because at first I thought, you know, I kind of felt about her the way Ellis's parents did. Like, she's just a party girl and shallow, hedonistic. But by the end, I think she changed a lot. You know, she started doing all this stuff for the war effort and stuff like that. So
yeah, and help when other bad things happen.
Yeah.
Yeah, she did. She's the one that really grew a lot. Yeah, well, I mean, she led this sheltered life, and she led this life, like you said, where she could, you know, she didn't have any real responsibilities, that mm-hmm. she could just, you know, party with her friends and yep. and just not have to worry about anything. And then all of a sudden she got thrown into a totally different situation, one that she wasn't used to at all.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it showed that there was some character underneath there. It just, she just needed a little extra nudging. So, yeah, in the long run, her father may have seemed heartless, but he really helped her and pushed her to be on her own 2 feet.
Yep.
And then when she inherited all the money when he died, then she would know what to do with it. And too, of course, you know, originally Ellis was thinking, oh, goody, you know, we're going to be filthy rich. But he ended up dead. He's the one that ended up dead. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, if he hadn't tried to kill her, he was trying to take her and have her locked up in the psychiatric hospital for the rest of her days. And then, especially because of the laws back then, he would have had all her fortune, and he and Hank could have done whatever they wanted. They could have gone off to any place and just, you know, not had to worry about anything. So
yeah, and a lot of men, a lot of husbands used to do that in those days.
Yeah.
We've read other books like Blue Asylum or whatever, where husbands do just that, throw their wives in mental asylums.
No, yeah. Back then it was pretty easy. It's like the husband had the say-so over just about everything.
Exactly.
So I could see why she was scared out of her wits, because she could see how there was nothing she could do. But, you know, fortunately, his plans were thwarted, and she was able to move on and have a good life with Angus and the other people, you know, her other friends she'd made. And it was nice, too, that poor Meg, you thought, well, she was scarred for life and nothing good was going to happen. But she ended up getting married, too. I thought that was really sweet.
Mm-hmm.
They found out Angus was the new laird, you know, because they were trying to, that was another thing Ellis was trying to do, is get him arrested and locked up, because supposedly he'd been poaching this wild game and all to help feed them. But then they found out, well, couldn't do that because he was the new laird. So mm-hmm. that was kind of neat to me that he was the new laird, and they didn't have to worry. They could use this big old house to help other people. So it was, mm-hmm. That's the other part. I like the scenes towards the end where things kind of came together, and even through all the tragedy and horror, there could, you know, be some happy ending after the war.
Yeah. From the group, a few people have posted that they finished it. Faith posted today she gave it a C+. I think Cheryl gave it a C as well. I gave it a C-. And you?
I'm going to give it a B.
Good. There's hope for the overall grade. Yeah, so, you know, I'm looking forward to the discussion to see what everyone else's thoughts are about it.
It's up to people their own opinion. Everybody's going to have a strong opinion, probably one way or the other.
Yeah,
even this book.
I renamed it. You know, I like renaming books that bore me. I renamed it. So the new title is At the Edge of Yawning.
That's clever. That's
kept me at the edge of yawning. So, yeah. But all in good fun. All in good fun. I hope they make a movie. I would definitely watch the movie because I think I might enjoy it more, like I did with Water for Elephants.
Yes, I would watch it.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. So that's our discussion of At the Water's Edge by Sara Gruen. Thanks for listening. Leave us your comments. Let us know what you think. Did you enjoy the book? Did you not enjoy it? And let us know why. And stay tuned for our next episode. We will be discussing Broken Promise by Linwood Barclay. See you next time. Bye.
Bye.